We make about 45 million pounds of chips in a quarter. That equates to about 200 million pounds of potatoes, which is quite a few. What's interesting with M&T is they're a small town bank, and as we've grown, they've also grown with us. They've got the resources that you would need in order to go big, but they also have that friendly local community feel so that it makes it seem easier than it probably is.
Hello. Welcome to our candidate forums. I'm Fred Levering, and today I'll have the opportunity to speak with one of the candidates for the office of Sheriff of Berks County. As you know, the general election is coming up in a hurry, Tuesday, November the 5th, and you still do have a little bit of time to get registered to vote. I believe you can continue to do that through October the 7th. So hurry and do that if you haven't. We need your participation. As I said, today we're going to speak with one of our candidates for sheriff. We have Mr. Bart Ganster with us today. He is currently working as a constable, and we'd like to start out, Bart, by asking you a little bit about yourself and why do you think your particular background suits you well to be a sheriff for Berks County?
Okay, thank you, Fred. I want to thank Berks County Television for having me here today. I am Bart Ganster, and I've been a Pennsylvania State Constable for the last 22 years. I've also been a business owner in Berks County for the last 39 years. I've been endorsed recently by the Fraternal Order of Police, Lodge 71 of Berks County. I'm also endorsed by the United Labor Council. As a constable, I've serviced the magisterial district judges, mostly everyone in Berks County. There are 17 in Berks County. I've worked for prison transports, civil process, arresting warrant searches, I just think that with the 22 years of street experience, that I think I'd like to bring into working for the common pleas level of court. I think it's time for new ears, new eyes, and new tactics, and I think that's why we need to have Ganster for sheriff on November the 5th.
So, perhaps you could start out just outlining a few of the general responsibilities of what does the sheriff's office do on behalf of the citizens?
Well, the sheriff's office is there to actually work for the common pleas level of court. They're to secure the courthouse, to secure the courtrooms, serve civil process, serve protection of abuse orders, also transport prisoners to and from prisons and to and from court. And also they have a dog unit, they have a canine crew, which I believe they use in the search of the warrant search. They have a good warrant team, I must say that. My plan, though, is to enhance the training of the warrant team and work on safety and training for gun control. The Sheriff's Office also does take care of concealed weapons permits, which I'm a supporter of that. I'm kind of against the open carry law because I think it's very dangerous on the fact that somebody could be carrying a gun with an improper holster. And you know, there's a lot of crazy people out there that might want to grab that gun and use it. So I'm a little worried about the open carry law. But again, I'm here to enforce the Constitution of the United States, the Second Amendment, and I will uphold it and do what needs to be done to make that office secure that type of thing. So that's where I'm at with that.
Now, the Sheriff's Department has about how many deputies, how many employees overall, but how many deputies?
Well, from what I understand, there's 95 deputies. And there's 12 civilian employees. So it's a staff of 107. I believe there's a fleet of 30 vehicles, and there's five canines. So what I would like to do is, when I look at the department, from what I know of it, again, I'm not in there, I don't work there, but from what I see the sheriff's department is open from 9 to 5. I think most of the employees work 9 to 5, Monday through Friday, except for those in the cell block, because they do take care of a cell block, and it's called central processing at the courthouse. I know those shifts are 24/7, 365 days a year they're in there, and I think what we need to do is utilize the staff a little bit different. I think we need to be out later at night, work weekends. When I say that, I mean for the civil process. There's a civil process where they serve civil papers, and also with the PFA removals and PFA process, I think we need to have more deputies out at different hours of the day doing that type of work. Also, they do sheriff sales, and you know, and I believe that's done on a certain day and time. But my feeling is that to make the staff more efficient to serve Berks County citizens, I think we'd need to be a three-shift, seven-day-a-week operation.
Does that require then more people?
I don't think so. I mean, until I get in there and utilize, see how I can utilize the staff. There is problems with the staffing. I guess we'll talk about it a little later, with trying to keep the deputies and trying to get more involved to hire deputies, to get more people to apply. So I guess, can we touch on that right now?
Sure.
Get on right now while I'm on that subject.
You're on it.
My feeling is the morale needs to be boosted. I think there's time for a change of climate, a change of culture in the Sheriff's Department. I feel that the deputies need to be given assignments. And then when they give those assignments, when they complete them, I think they need to be acknowledged that they did the assignment, that they did it well, and they need to be moved up and advanced in the proper channels when that stuff happens. I don't see that now. I see our sheriff is a popular sheriff, and it's about the sheriff. I feel the department should be about the department. I think leadership needs to be more about the people that work for you than yourself. You know what I mean? That's the way I feel about it. So I think a change of the environment of the Sheriff's Department is needed. I know my opponent has been in there for 35 years, 12 as a sheriff, and 23 as a deputy, which is a long time. And I think that's why I think it's time for a change.
Does this have a budget impact then?
His budget, as I know, as we look at the fiscal responsibility, in the last 3 years, 2017, 2018, and projected 2019, his budget is going up $386,000. Whether how much that is overtime, and I don't know that. I don't have those figures. We did try to get some figures with the Right to Know Act, but that takes at least 30 days to get, and we've been waiting. So we're waiting on that. Again, I'm an opponent running against an incumbent. I expect that to happen, you know. But again, you know, to me, till I get in there and see how the staff is working and make the changes. But I think changes need to be made, and I think we can be more efficient and streamline things with the way if we change the way that they do things in the Sheriff's Department. And that's what my goal is to do.
Well, now you mentioned that you have been serving for quite a while as a constable. Mm-hmm. How does that relate? How do you see what work experiences do you bring from that will benefit this office?
Well, what I bring from the constable is, you know, I provide a service. I provide that service to the DJ level of courts. I've done it for 22 years. I've served a lot of courts. I serve the warrants. The sheriff served the warrants. The deputies serve the warrants, I should say. The deputies do the prison transports. I do the prison transports. When it comes to, I know what they have to do because I do it. So I know the process that they have to do. I do levies. I do evictions. You know, I do everything that the sheriff's department does. As the sheriff, I believe you're there to administrate that you see it goes right, that it goes proper and it's done properly. I'm a kind of hands-on guy, and I kind of think I'm going to be right there with them doing the work. And my policy is I hate to have somebody do something that I wouldn't do. So that's the way I am. So I would do it with them. I'm about labor. You know what I mean? I'm about labor. I worked for the union prior to becoming a constable. I'm back, like I said, I am backed by the Fraternal Order Police. I'm backed by the United Labor Council. I'm not looking to make it hard on the deputies. I'm trying to make it easier on the deputies, safer on the deputies, train them, get them better training, enhance their training. And then I also, I kind of like to have an open door policy. I like to meet with the deputies biweekly and hear their suggestions, hear their complaints, give me the ideas that they think could work, and try to work together amongst them with the union. I know they're represented by a union, and I don't have a problem working with them to try to make everything better for the citizens of Berks County.
Well, now you've mentioned that there's some related things between the constable's office and the deputy sheriff's. Is there duplication that we're wasting money on there?
No, because what I do as a constable, we work for the lower level of courts, and the sheriff works for the common pleas level of court. So it's the next step up. process is done at the starts at the lower level and then goes to the upper level. So I don't think it's being duplicated. I mean, there is things that a constable does that the sheriff also does when it comes to hauling, transporting prisoners, transporting people that have just been arrested from different police departments. Years ago, a constable, if a police department had arrested somebody, they would call a constable to come pick them up and bring them into the court. With the central processing the way it is now, the police leave their site and bring them into the courthouse, which some departments are left, some areas are left unmanned then, because there might only be one patrolman on at night, in the middle of the night or something. So it doesn't, it's a safety issue. There's a big thing about the cost of constables, I always say this, and this is the truth. A constable only charges when he does the work. So if there's no work, there's no cost. Costs are reimbursed by the defendant. When it comes to having a sheriff deputy, and I'll give this example, if he's going out to serve a process or looking for somebody with a warrant, they're going to knock on the door. And if nobody answers the door, they're going to get in their car and they're going to drive away. Because they're a salaried employee or an hourly rate employee. If a constable goes to that door, they're going to knock on that door until the neighbor answers it, because he's not going to get paid until he gets that person. So that's a little bit of, you know, different type of work ethic there, you know what I mean? So it's not really, you know, they do the same, but they don't do the same. Different venue there. A constable is a subcontractor of the state, of the county, of each county, and is paid with a 1099. He doesn't get any benefits or anything like that, where the sheriff deputy is going to cost. Like, they talk about replacing the constables with sheriff deputies. It would be unbelievable that taxpayers could never afford to do that.
Well, now you've talked about the process of serving things and so on. Can you describe that a bit for the viewers?
Well, when it comes to, when I say serving a process, maybe like a civil complaint, where if someone's being sued, what happens at the DJ level, a lawsuit, a suit, it goes from $0 to $15,000. Any suit over $15,000 now becomes a common pleas level of court issue. So then the sheriff would serve that. So when I say you serve that, you have to go knock on the door. You get an address, you knock on the door, you try to find a person. The person comes to the door, you serve them the paperwork. Again, that constable isn't going to get paid unless that paperwork's served. If the sheriff's department doesn't get the paperwork served, it'll be returned. It'll be returned back to the plaintiff. It can't be served. Same thing happens with a constable, but the sheriff is getting paid no matter what. The constable doesn't get paid unless he gets the service. When it comes to an arrest warrant, they do the same. Right now, constables are limited, not able to do criminal warrants. Back when I started, that was the first thing we did. We went after the criminals. That's what we wanted. Everybody wanted a criminal warrant, a felony offense or a misdemeanor offense. That's what the district judges wanted. They wanted those people picked up. They've now taken that away from the constables and given it all to the sheriffs. I don't know why they've done that, but that's what they did. So a constable will go after summary offenses, and then the sheriff will go after the criminal, misdemeanor, and felony offenses. Process is done a little different. Sheriff sends as many deputies as he needs. The constable goes either by himself or with one other constable. And that's the way it works.
Are both constables and deputy sheriffs armed?
Yes. There's different training. You know, there's a sheriff's training and then there's a constable's training. We all have to go be certified, and then you have to be recertified every year as far as with your pistol and with your continuing education. And the sheriffs do the same thing.
Now, you know, you've described being hands-on and mm-hmm. so on. Earlier, you also said that you thought that the deputies needed to be acknowledged and so on. Is there enough time in the day for the sheriff, the head of the department, to be able to actually be doing work as well as doing that administration and morale boosting, as you called it?
Well, I look at it this way. My life has been, I work all the time. It's not going to change. So if I can spend time on the street with my deputies during the day, I'll do my paperwork at night. Okay, I don't have a problem putting in an 18 or 19 hour day. I've been doing it for 22 years. So I feel that I need to do that. I need to be part of their process as well as the process to administrate them. And that's what we're gonna do. We're gonna make it happen.
Now, how's technology, everything's technology driven these days, it seems. Do you see opportunities to modernize, or whatever the right word would be, things within the department that might be able to free up people to do the face-to-face stuff instead of paperwork?
Well, no, I don't know about that. I mean, I feel the department, I mean, the computer programs are there, the search engines are there to find people, to find addresses. I think that's probably going to, you know, if it gets better, that's great. I don't know how good that's going to get, but I feel there's enough deputies. 95 deputies, I believe that would be enough. You know, there's two deputies in each courtroom of the Common Pleas Court, you know what I mean? And then you have, you know, you have the processing center downstairs. You have warrant people out on the warrant division. You have people doing civil division. I just think the way it needs to be readjusted, okay? I need to get in there and see how many people we have doing, see that the deputies can do multiple jobs. You know, I mean, if a Common Pleas judge calls off and there's two deputies in that courtroom, what are we doing with those deputies? Well, I've heard my opponent say, well, they go downstairs, they try to find something to do. I don't believe that. Okay, let's secure the courthouse. We have an unsecured courthouse. That's one of my biggest things, securing. That's the first thing I want to do is secure our house. And that is to put an armed deputy at every door. Now, that doesn't mean get rid of the security force that's there. They have an outside security force. That's fine. They're unarmed. I want to put an armed deputy at every door. You have dogs. You have five dogs. I want to see the dogs at the doors. I want to see the dogs walking the perimeter of the courthouse and the services center. Okay, let's utilize these deputies so it needs to be done that way. My opponent claims if you're going to put a deputy at each door, you're going to have to pay overtime. I don't believe that. I believe there's enough downtime with deputies that we could cover those doors. Okay, so that's one thing I want to do. You know, we've had issues. We've had a naked guy run into the courthouse right past the security guard in the middle of the night, made it to the third or fourth floor. We had a suspicious package come in one night or one afternoon, made it to the fourth floor. That stuff shouldn't happen. Okay, we need to do action, not reaction, and that's why we need to make a change and get things going the way they should be going.
And you believe that there are enough people there already to be able to accomplish that?
Absolutely. Absolutely, I do.
Well, that's an interesting point. Mm-hmm. I saw an article in the local paper not too long ago that with a staff as large as you were proposing to manage, there's always got to be some turnover and stuff like that. And apparently there's some difficulties these days in recruiting new people. I've heard some of the local police departments making the same comment that when they offer a test for a position, that they're not getting the response that they used to get. Any thoughts on that as to how you might enhance that? And why isn't in the first place that we have a problem attracting people to law enforcement?
Well, I think the thing we have to do there, it's about education. I think we need to educate. I think we need to get into the high schools and not just in the suburbs. I think we need to get in the city, get the inner city children, the inner city kids that are ready to graduate high school, to try to get to them and recruit them like they do for the service. They recruit you for this. They have recruiters come in and they sell their product to get you into the service. We need to do the same thing with the sheriff's department. We need to educate. I think every deputy that we have should be educated on how to be a recruiter. They can recruit as they see people on the street, as they get in more involved. That's another thing I want. I want a little bit more community involvement. I want a little bit more community involvement in what we have. I'd like to get it in town hall meetings on a regular basis, hear the citizens of Berks County's problems, get into these schools, talk to them about encouraging them to get into, make a career out of being a sheriff deputy. And I know they say, well, maybe the pay isn't as good as becoming a policeman. I know they send the new cadet to school, he gets his training, and then he leaves and goes to a police department because the money's better, and that's why they do that. And that's something maybe we can work on in negotiations and contract negotiations, try to boost the pay a little bit. Maybe we can save some money somewhere where we could boost the pay of the deputies to keep it more inviting to stay there, to stay with us. But again, I think we need to educate, to recruit. We need to be more in the schools to put programs maybe in the school where they can get involved. I know they do have a Explorer program that the Sheriff's Department does have. I think we need to get more involved in that, put maybe more deputies to get involved in it, try to get out there and sell the product. Maybe spend some advertisement money in trying to boost the interest in being a sheriff. And again, I think by changing the climate and changing the culture of the way the sheriff department is run, making more of the deputies feel more wanted and that they're more valuable to the department, encouraging them and crediting them when they get something done, put their picture in the paper, put their picture in the magazine, the deputies that are doing the work, I think maybe they'll want to stay there a little longer and move up through the ranks. That's what I think we could do.
The national news, the controversies that we read about on occasion, it seems like they've diminished, perhaps, people becoming interested in a law enforcement career. Have you sensed that?
Absolutely. I mean, if you look at social media, I mean, there's cops being shot every day. It's a very dangerous job nowadays. It's very dangerous. They're being shot in the back. They're sitting in the car doing their paperwork, and people are walking up and shooting them. That's an issue. That's a big issue, and that's probably why it's like it is. That's why nobody wants to get involved in it. You know what I mean? So proper training, proper gear. That's, you know, you got to make sure that all happens. And this department does. They do have that. You know, they do train, and they do have the proper gear. But we need to enhance that training a little more. We need to do more training, more hands-on training. We talk about courtroom scenario training. I talked to some of the deputies. None of them have ever had a courtroom scenario training, and I think that should be something that's done on a monthly basis. You know, I look at it as in the courtroom, you have people come in, and, oh, yeah, they pat them down, but there's dangerous people out there. There's people that can fight without weapons. There's people that will make this a weapon and hurt somebody, kill somebody. You know what I mean? It's just people are trained to do different things, and there's a lot of problems out there in this world, and I just think we should be more educated and more advanced and more ready. We should have action and not reaction. We should be ready to attack anything that needs to attack us, and that's where that's what I'm about with my training. So,
well, this has been a very interesting conversation, but as I told you, time goes by rather quickly when you get into these things. So in our last couple of minutes here, why don't you just tell us why you should be elected? You know, give us a synopsis of where you think we can head and why you are the better choice.
Well, as I say, you know, I think longevity is a good thing in one aspect, but I think being in charge of a department for a long period of time, you get stale. You know, you get complacent. I feel that this sheriff, and again, I'm for the Second Amendment and I'm for the gun carrying permit, but I feel that this sheriff has made his office more about the Second Amendment, okay, and not about the common pleas level of court, the protection of the citizens of Berks County. And don't get me wrong, the Second Amendment is protection also, but we're talking about a job that's designed to service the common pleas level of court and to protect the Berks County citizens that are in the courthouse and have dealings with the court system. And that's what the Sheriff's Department is designed, transporting prisoners. I just feel with new ideas, new tactics, enhancing the training, securing the courthouse is a big it's a big issue with me. And I just think we need to get more involved with the community, with the inner city. I don't feel our sheriff does that. I don't feel he's in the inner city enough, and that's where I'm at. That's why I just think I got to be there to try to make things better for the citizens of Berks County, try to make the county safe, and that's what I think. That's why I think I'm the better candidate. Okay, I got good ideas. I've been on the street. I got a lot of good stuff I want to try, and I'm willing to listen to my employees. I'm willing to listen to see what they say. I want to have an open door policy. If, you know, Fred wants to come in and give me some advice, I'm not going to say no. I'm going to listen to your advice. I'm going to see if it works for me, and I'm going to use it. That's the kind of guy I am. If it works for us all, that's what we're going to do. So I want an open door policy to the community. I want an open door policy to my employees, and I want to become, I want to build the leadership from with my people. I want my people to become great leaders, great deputies, go on to be captains and sergeants of the department, and maybe one day run for sheriff. That's what I'm looking at. So,
well, that was a very interesting take on things. We are at the conclusion of our program. I want to thank you again for joining us today, and again remind you that the general election is on Tuesday, November the 5th, coming up in a hurry. You still have a few days, though, to get registered if you haven't. Got to be done by the 7th of October. So please get out there and vote. If you're not registered, please do that. Your voice is very important. We get hung up these days on all the national stuff, but these local issues and these local candidacies have more to do with our day-to-day lives than any of that national stuff. Thanks a lot for joining us. Goodbye.
We make about 45 million pounds of chips in a quarter. That equates to about 200 million pounds of potatoes, which is quite a few. What's interesting with M&T is they're a small town bank, and as we've grown, they've also grown with us. They've got the resources that you would need in order to go big, but they also have that friendly local community feel so that it makes it seem easier than it probably is.